Okay, we're going to begin this morning with panel discussion on the topic transition to sustainment. Lieutenant General retired Mitch Stevenson is the moderator. He is also the senior account manager at SAIC. And co-chairing the panel is Lieutenant General Pat McQuistion, Deputy CG of Army Materiel Command. Included in the panel is Lieutenant General Ray Mason, the Deputy Chief of Staff, G4, who most of you know. And joining him, them, is Major General Harold Greene, who's the Deputy for Acquisition Systems Management. And General Greene's been with us for the entire conference, and we appreciate that very much.
My pleasure, sir.
And then Graziano is the Vice President of Combat Support and Sustainment at General Dynamics. And Mr. Mike Ivey, who is Vice President and General Manager of Army Programs at Oshkosh Defense. So anyway, let me turn it over to them. And here we go.
All right.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming out a little early this morning. It's good to see such a large crowd here. General Sullivan's already introduced the panel. I just would add one thing. They are a little lacking in educational credentials. Actually, I was looking at their bios last night. Every one of the folks to my right has two, not one, but two advanced degrees. And the guy on the far right is a PhD in materials engineering and has four master's degrees.
Overachiever.
So,
wow.
Turn the panel over to Harry.
Just make us feel worse.
You got some intellectual capital sitting up here in front of you, but some very, very, very smart guys
that cheat off now.
Can talk to this topic. So, transition to sustainment. What the heck does that mean? I deliberately gave no guidance in terms of how to interpret the subject of the panel to the panel members, and wanted each of them to come up with their own way of interpreting what that meant to them. And they've done a fine job, I think you'll see, as we get into their presentations. You know, it could mean anything from what I thought when I first heard the term, which was transitioning from something funded by the equipping peg to something funded by the sustaining peg. Or maybe it means not many new starts in our future because of the financial considerations that are going on in the DOD and in the country. Or maybe it means sustaining the skills learned after 12 years of war. But all of them will have a different twist on that, and I think you'll find it interesting. I would ask you to listen up and engage when it's time for the Q&A. They'll each do about 10 minutes or so of presentation, and then we'd like to spend the last half hour that we have with you this morning hearing from you and hearing what your questions are and or your comments as to what you've heard. So without any further ado, I'd like to introduce the first panel member, Lieutenant General Ray Mason, our G4.
Thanks, Mitch, and good morning. You know, it's, as I said, it is good to be here, and it's good to see so many of y'all here. I don't know if you all are early risers or you're just coming in from the bars in Lauderdale and you got no place else to go right now. But I've been the G4 for 15 months, and in those 15 months, you know, the organization's kind of been on autopilot because my predecessor picked great people and set up great policies and programs, and if he was around, I would thank him. But Mitch, thanks. Thanks. You turned over a great team, and I've been blessed to inherit that. I'd start with two thoughts. First thought is, as I mentioned, the G4 is, most of you know, most of the DA staff, including my battle buddy Jim Barkley down there on the G8, we deal with policy and programs. And it's important ever so often to reflect back on that and realize you're not actually running operations, although sometimes we think we do that and we'd like to do that. But we're about policies and programs. So one of the things I remind myself and my team every day is that the policies and programs we come up with in the five-sided building, some young soldier out there on Freedom's Frontier has got to execute that. And I think, again, whatever ideas you come up with industry, whatever ideas we come up with on the uniform side, and our great civilian counterparts, some young soldiers got to execute that, and I think that's an important thing to keep in mind. The second kind of big thought I'd give you is, so we're going through sequestration, or soon will, and we've had the, you know, the Budget Control Act last year. We've got continuing resolutions. We've got sequestrations. A lot of people call it the perfect storm, and it's, you know, tough days. Okay, they are tough days, but then I think about young private young sergeant that gets up every morning in Afghanistan or did it for 10 years in Iraq and straps on their body armor and goes out and conducts patrols, and they don't know if that's the day their number's up. And yet they do it. They get up, they strap that body armor on, and they do the things that the nation and their leaders have asked them to do. So my day, your day, is not anywhere near as tough as that young soldier that's got to go out there on that patrol. And that puts it in perspective. So if they can deal with it, I'm pretty sure we're going to be able to deal with the things that we've got to deal with, as tough as they are and as catastrophic as they are. So transition. As General Shinseki used to say, transitions are the hardest things to manage, to lead, but leaders better have their hands on them. So we've been thinking about transition for quite some time, certainly in the G4. Mitch Stevenson mentioned transition from the equipping peg to the sustaining peg, and there's a piece that I'll talk a little bit about that. But there's lots of pieces to transition. I'll hit the wave tops here in a couple of slides, and hopefully it'll generate some thoughts and some questions. So next slide. Next slide. Okay, so programs. There are significantly large programs in the Army that are coming out of acquisition and production that Harry Greene's been working and Jim Barkley has been working on that are going to come into the sustainment peg. The sustainment peg, program executive group there, is about 5% of the Army's TOA. So we're a relatively small piece of the Army's total budget, but key to sustainment and lifecycle management and those kinds of things. Obviously, the biggest piece is personnel, and the equipping comes shortly thereafter. But my concern is the overall pie of the Army is getting smaller, obviously, and then my piece of that pie, that 5%, I actually need a bigger piece of that pie to help Pat McQuistion and AMC do all the things she's got to do, from down at the unit level all the way up through depot. So I'm in a stratcoms describing to the Army leadership why I've got to gobble up a little bigger piece of the pie. It's about 100 systems, as you see, over the palm that are coming in, and you can just see those are the big ones that are going to be there. So it is about relationships. It is about partnerships in the AMC community, the ASALT community with Ms. Hsu, the lifecycle management commands, and G4 all together working our way through that with trade-offs of what we can afford and what we can't afford. The bottom of the chart I'll get you is to talk to you through is some things we're trying to do to heal ourselves. Because while I'd like more than 5% of the TOA, I know that I've got a challenge trying to get those kind of dollars. So I'm also demonstrating our team, the G4, with our partners, is demonstrating those things we're trying to do to be more efficient. The good news in depot maintenance is over the past 10 years, with the work that AMC's done and our commercial partners, in 1999, about 85% of our ground fleet, needed depot maintenance. Today, that's 15%, and that's been done through reset OCO dollars. So we've infused an incredible amount of readiness into our fleets, and the aviation fleet I would offer as well. The challenge is we don't want to go back to where we were in 1999. How did we get there? It was the peace dividend of the 90s, the Cold War's over with, Berlin Wall comes down, and we end up with the vast majority of our fleets needing depot maintenance. So how do we prevent from going back there again? How do we stay in that band of excellence? I don't have all the answers, but that's a lot of the transition stuff we're focused on. The third bullet down about increasingly important role, transition to Army 2020 and beyond. The thoughts there are we're becoming much more of an ACONUS-based Army. There's some good news of that, and there's some bad news of that. Good news is you kind of get economies of scale when your forces and your capabilities and your infrastructure is more located in one place. Tough part is you got to get to wherever the battle is. And if you just look at, and I remember when General Stevenson was the four and DAG4 and I was down at Forcecom, we did an AAR in Haiti. Here was an operation that was a humanitarian aid operation. People weren't shooting at each other, but I got to tell you, we did not cover ourselves in glory with getting out of Dodge to get to Haiti. Learned some lessons from that, trying to put those things in place. But so we've got a rapid expeditionary challenge with Army 2020 and beyond. Actually, 2 o'clock, AM call tonight. I talked about this shift from procurement to sustainment. We've got to make our stuff last longer. We've got to take better care of it. And so because we know those resources are decreasing. If you look at that, the slides went dead. So what are some of the cost mitigation strategies we're putting in place? And I'll cover about 6 of them. First is what we call pass-back maintenance policy, and that is I kind of equate it to over the last 10 years we run a rental car company where a soldier would go get a piece of equipment, They'd use it, they'd drop it off, and some great contractor would take care of it. We did that because we could, using General Stevenson, as I quote him often. We did that because we could. And there was a lot of goodness in that. All the contractors are downrange, and there will always be contractors on the battlefield. But we created some unintended consequences in our discipline and in our skill sets in maintenance supply and things of that nature. So this pass-back maintenance basically says you will use every ounce of capability inside the MTOW force before you're going to pass it back to DOL, before you're going to pass it back to some contractor. I think you'd all agree that that certainly makes sense. We've got a force of soldiers that are already there trained and ready to do maintenance, and we ought to have them do that. So that's what the pass-back maintenance is about. So that allows those soldiers to get back to those core maintenance and supply competencies. And this balance between organic and contractor logistics support, and it is a balance. In some places, we may want 100% CLS. Other places, we may want zero. We've kind of thrown money at problems in the last 10 years, and we're not going to have that luxury, certainly here in the near to midterm. So we're looking at that constantly. Field service reps. We're trying to figure out how to make those more multi-capable, where they're not just working on one system, they're working on multi-systems, similar to how the Ordnance Center has come up with a multi-capable mechanic. So we have a mechanic now that does not only turret, but he does the drivetrain of an M1 tank or a Bradley. We used to have separate MOSs for that. So given a soldier, that's much more a pentathlete kind of idea. Minimizing non-standard equipment, but that's a double-edged sword because we want to field new equipment, the latest and greatest systems, just take the MRAP, for example, to our troops. But again, there's an unintended consequences of all this non-standard equipment on the battlefield. It's the sustainment tail that goes with it, the repair parts, the manuals, the mechanics, all those things that lag with a system that you field rapidly. But again, I think there's a balance here. We're divesting those systems and equipment we no longer need. And one of the most quintessential examples is tactical wheeled vehicles. So in the last 17 months, we've divested 17,000 vehicles that are usually obsolete or older models. We've got to speed up that, because right now today, we've got about 270,000 vehicles. We're authorized about 220,000 vehicles, give or take a few. That's the number is constantly moving. So that's, 40, 50,000. And there's talk about driving that down even further. And so some of the concepts we're developing is that TRADOC's working on is, it, which many of us grew up with, is called weight the main effort. So not every brigade is going to get everything it needs. Maybe it doesn't need to operate for 72 hours. Maybe it can operate for 48, and you can push the next day of supply up to echelons above brigade. We built the modular brigades to be really autonomous and operate on the battle space, for X amount of time, be 100% mobile. We don't think we can afford that. So we're pooling resources, trucks specifically, and things of that nature. And then we've got to optimize post-production software support. Those costs are exponentially. If you could go forward, let's try this, two slides, and I'll come back to this slide in a minute. Go one more. So this is a slide I used. Look at a Humvee in 1999. If you were a commander, you had a radio, and maybe you had a speaker. Now, there's a Humvee in the year 2012, or an MRAP, depending on what vehicle you got. Look what's inside of it. So think about at the unit level, OMA dollars, op tempo, taking care of a Humvee in 1999 cost X. In a unit motor pool in the year 2012, it's X to some exponent. I mean, it's just off the scale. And that also deals at the depot level, trying to reset all that stuff. And every one of those pieces of kit requires software. Our costs have just skyrocketed, just like, the economy's dealing with the healthcare. Those costs have gone through the roof. Each soldier is more expensive, and the kit we put on a soldier, we have a similar slide like this for what a soldier costs. Basically, in the 90s, to outfit a soldier was about $2,500 with all the kit they needed. Today, it's somewhere around $20,000 with all the kit they've got to outfit an individual soldier. One of the points is not every vehicle can look like that. Not every soldier can have all that equipment. What's the right hierarchical? What's the right banding? What's the right piece in there? If you go back to the slide, back to, thanks. Back one more, please. So that box, that's what that box about is to the right. So how do we handle that transition from a 1990-era Humvee to a 2012-2013 era and trying to reduce those software costs? One of them is by buying licenses, which may or may not sound good to to our commercial partners. Okay, next slide. So really there's kind of three rheostats that the senior leadership of the Army can turn. There's force structure, obviously, and the people that are involved in that. You can have modernization rheostat you turn, and that's our insurance policy for the future. And then you've got current readiness. And current readiness is all about being able to get out of Dodge, go fight a war tonight. And so you've got to balance those three things. So as you know, we're taking the Army down, and so saving some dollars in force structure to allow us to put dollars against modernization and current readiness. So what are we doing in force structure? You know, we're going from COIN operations and SFABs, those into decisive operations, combined arms maneuver and wide area security. It's kind of somewhat back to the future. It's a little bit like air-land battle, but not so much. On the battle space, in one area, you might be conducting a tank-on-tank operation. Another place, you might be conducting a COIN operation. You're dealing with terrorists. You're dealing with criminal activity. You're dealing with the local mayor, all that happening simultaneously within a brigade battle space. So we've got to fully leverage all those capabilities that are out there, soldiers, DA civilians, certainly the contractor mix, as I said. What keeps me up at night is this issue of anti-access and area denial. If you think about what we've had for our last several wars is a place called Kuwait. It is a sanctuary. It is a kind of an intermediate staging base. You could build up for months thousands of supplies, tons of stuff, soldiers, and then go across the berm. I would say that what we've seen over the last year in Afghanistan with the PAC GLOC is a harbinger of things to come. I suspect whatever competitor we fight in the future, they're going to try to keep us from building up in a place like Kuwait. Region-aligned forces. This is about being a CONUS-based army, but aligning forces, brigades, and other kinds of units to a COCOM. Lots more going on with that, and I think that all the COCOMs are very happy and very interested, particularly those that haven't had a lot of forces, Army forces, in the last 10 years. This ACRC mix, we're working hard. About 70 to 80% of the sustainment capability of the Army is in the reserves. That's fine, that's okay, but where's that balance with early deployers? And so we're working, making sure that we've got the right folks in there for the first 30 days of combat. Modernization. I talked about unique equipping solutions. You know, for just a tactical wheeled vehicle, we have hundreds of LINs, line item numbers. That's complicated, it's friction, it's trying to count for it. It's boutique solutions. You know, the Marines kind of go to one solution. They go to a 10-ton truck. They probably do that because they're a small force. We go to all kinds of solutions. We've got to figure out how to narrow that band. We're going to invest in operational energy. We're continuing to do that. And that's all about reducing tactical risks, putting less soldiers on the roads with IEDs, but also reducing our strategic reliance on fossil fuels. Auditability. We're fielding G Army. General Stevenson worked incredibly hard. He kind of set the conditions for that. We're taking our supply, our maintenance, and our property book systems and folding it down into one ERP, Enterprise Resourcing Planning Program. It's gonna have 160 users, $4 billion. We'll field it over the next 4 years. It's gonna dramatically change the way we do logistics at the tactical level. AMC's already done theirs, Logistics Modernization Program, LMP, and it's gone very well. Not without challenges, but it's gone well. Readiness. Used to be, we managed readiness and we allocated resources against ALOs, authorized lines. We had authorized required on the MTO. We had IRC A, Bs, and Cs, and PECTEFs, and all these things. We used to be able to stratify readiness. When we went to R4 Gen, all that kind of went away. We went to aim points. We're trying to figure out, as you have less units deploy, what is the right mix to have readiness. We published and got signed by the Undersecretary of the Army, the Army's Organic Industrial Base Strategic Plan. It optimizes our industrial base, both their arsenals and our hard iron depots. We can talk about that later in Q&A, but that's really setting the stage for force structure, modernization, all those capabilities. And then, as I said, we're focused on training, and particularly what I want to focus on is going back to doing EDRIs, CDRIs. So as we become more and more CONUS-based, we make sure that we can answer that 2 a.m. call to get out of Dodge quickly. We're a very, very good Army at deploying to a LAD, a latest arrival date. You know, that gives you a year to plan it. But we're not so good, as I said, getting out of Dodge when you get that call in the middle of the night. So that's all I've got. So, Graz, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. So thank you for asking me to participate on the panel. General Sullivan, thank you for what you and your organization do to support our Army. On a personal note, I would tell you that as a father of two young officers who have multiple combat tours, on behalf of their mother, I would say thank you for making sure that working hard to make sure they always had what they need to do to execute their responsibilities. So thank you very much. Some of you, I know quite a few of you in the audience, and you're probably very surprised to see me on this panel. If my two immigrant parents were alive, I can assure you they would question your judgment. My mother in particular, she would wonder why you would have a guy whose best 4 years of his life up to this point was the eighth grade up here with these distinguished panelists. But nonetheless, I'm here, and for all those reasons, I have a single slide that I would like to talk to with some prepared notes, if I might. So, slide, please. So, for my part, I believe as our Army transitions from war to sustainment, our Army must operate in this new normal strategic environment, and I'd like to talk to that a little bit. A little contrast, as a young Army officer, and some of you may remember this as well, planning and operating during the Cold War, I think we operated in a certain uncertain environment. And what I mean by that is the environment we operated in and the adversary we faced were fairly well known. If we did A, they probably would do B and C, and we would do D. Didn't mean it wasn't very, very dangerous. It was just different. We operated from general defense positions. Some of you remember those GDPs. We stood on those positions. We accepted the enemy in multiple times. We knew the regimental commanders' names. We knew their backgrounds that we would face, and we all planned for that. Now, it's not clear to me when that started to change. It could have been the end of when the Iron Curtain came down. It could have been something as simple as when General Gaspagonis stood at the port in Saudi Arabia with handwritten 3x5 cards, trying to direct the forces in Operation Desert Storm. Some of you remember that. I'm not sure when it happened. I'm not smart enough to know when it happened, but I do believe that there's a new normal, and that new normal is going to be here. It is what it is. It's not like we're going to go back to something. And I believe it has broad implications for sustainment as we go forward. This environment, this strategic environment, and General Mason touched on it briefly, ambiguity reigns. It is very ambiguous. It is what I would call an uncertainty, from a certain uncertainty to an uncertain uncertainty. I believe it will demand our Army be agile and more agile. I know it's agile and much more tailorable. Our Army is going to need to send tailored forces on very short notice, to General Mason's point. As a member of a joint force, almost always as a member of a joint force, again, a very, very big difference over the years, over long distances, and then sustain them for as long as it takes. We just won't know. And as long as it takes. That's a different paradigm. Further, in my view, in the new normal, the Army faces global challenges, where the military, as you know, is one instrument of foreign policy, but how do you get to the other ones, right? I mean, how do you get economic? How do you put that on this kind of enemy? And how do you put political? I mean, most of them don't have flags. So, but the Army, for sustainment and for our Army, will require even more global reach. There's no question about that. Readiness at our post camps and stations will still be critical, as it was in my day, but not nearly as critical as the challenge of operating over those very long distances and sustaining those forces in venues where we probably will not have operated before. Guarantee it. Next, in this environment and an implication for sustainment, we may never know who our next adversary will be. Plato said a long time ago, only the dead have seen the end of war. None of us, all of us, wish for the alternative to that, but we know it will happen. And so we may not know who our adversary is, but we can be darn sure
that know that he will be very adaptive. He is watching now. He has been watching for the last 12 years. And we can be assured that he will be very adaptive. In my view, that will dictate that the transition to sustainment ensure that our Army has the industrial base technical reach back required for this ever adaptive enemy. Must have the industrial base technical reach back as a portion of the sustainment. Next, I would say that this speed of impending conflict in the new normal might demand that our Army be more responsive than ever, and General Mason did mention that. It seems that global incidents and the chaos that they cause are happening ever quicker. That may have something to do with the 24-hour news cycle. I don't know. It doesn't really matter. But we have to find a way, as we transition to sustainment, to plan on being able to get inside that cycle. Finally, in my view, the new strategic environment recognizes even more severe physical constraint, certainly more than I ever dealt with. The professionals, the uniformed professionals up here, are dealing with incredible challenges in this regard. But in the end, it will mean that as we transition to sustainment, that sustainment will need to be more affordable, period. I mean, that's our challenge, and it's a joint challenge. It's not General Mason's challenge. It's our challenge. So in short, in my view, in this environment, as we transition to sustainment, remembering that we're not there yet, we still have lots of our neighbors and sons and daughters in the fight, that we'll have to operate as a joint force in a very different environment and be significantly more agile, more tailorable. Our sustainment will need to be more responsive and affordable. And with those opening remarks, I thank you again for allowing me to be on the panel, and I'll turn it over to General McQuistion.
Graz, thank you very much. I appreciate that. And I also would like to thank AUSA and General Sullivan and TRADOC and Guy Swan for bringing this panel together, and our industry partners for participating, and also our allies I see out there in the audience. So thank you all for being here to listen to the presentation that we have today. Go ahead to the next slide, please, and the next one. Thank you. So in keeping with the theme of this year's winter meeting, you know, being ready, staying ready for America's next first battle, I borrowed this slide, and we updated a little bit from General Sullivan's days as the Chief Staff of the Army, where we took a look at the ebbs and flows of funding in consonance with the, you know, times of great conflict and the times of relative peace for our Army and our nation. And we can take a look back through time. We can take a look at the time when most of this panel came into the force in the late 70s. And early 80s, and we see that there is a dynamic of the ebbs and flows of funding related to what we are called upon to do. And so we plan for that. And, you know, as we come into this current period and we come out of operations, out of Iraq finally, out of Afghanistan, we plan for that decrease in requirements and the decrease in the things that we would need to outsource. What's changed for us from other periods, and every period is unique, I understand that everybody's had challenges through these preceding downturns, downslopes. What's unique to us right now is we don't know the slope of that downturn and the downsizing that's ahead of us. And so that is the fiscal uncertainty that we face, and that is something that we have to work our way through, because we must and we will be ready for the next first battle. General Mason talked about the three rheostats that the General Odierno uses as he discusses what his choices are, what our choices are for the future, and how do you balance among that force structure decision, the modernization that we need to keep investing in, and always maintaining readiness for what we need to do. And we've got a couple of guidance documents out there. We've got the defense budget priorities and choices, and we've got General Odierno's marching orders and his first addition to that, the Waypoint 1. General Stevenson talked to us about the, your comments about transitioning to sustainment as broad as you'd like. So when we think about it, we think about it in three broad fronts. We do talk about the weapon systems that need to move out of production into the sustainment portion of their life cycles. And we know that that's about, in the past, accounted for about 70% of the cost of weapon systems happens in the sustainment portion of their life cycles. As General Mason pointed out, with the complexity of the systems that we are operating with now, actually those costs increase. It's the software costs, it's the hardware costs, it's the integration costs of those systems now. It's also, we've extended the life cycle of our weapon systems. And so where we had planned to keep platforms in our Army for 20 to 25 years, now we will keep them much, much longer. We have benefited from the ability to be able to reset them. And so we have good readiness in the platforms now, but we have to maintain that readiness over time on aging platforms. The second broad front would be the units moving from commitments in CENTCOM. We still have some forces in Iraq that will, that we're continuing to support, and the broad effort in Afghanistan to bring those forces home, and then get them ready through reset programs and training programs for their next assignments, and maintaining readiness throughout that so that they are able to go and perform missions as a regionally aligned force or any other contingency operation that we are asked to perform. And then the third broad front is optimizing sustainment for reposturing forces here in the continental United States. And we call that the global logistics concept. And that really is a holistic approach to taking a look at our logistics force structure, active guard and reserve, the capacities and capabilities that we have at the tactical, the operational, and the strategic, the industrial base levels, and then where we will posture that as we see reposturing of our forces for the future. So that's an Army-wide endeavor that AMC and G4 are leading, and we will have the ability to make decisions, better decisions, based on future considerations and future planning for our Army. Next slide. So these are the things when we talk about transitioning to sustainment, some of our focus areas and where we see you are helping and continue to help. Number one for us is always supporting the current operations, but we have to simultaneously enable the retrograde and the reset from CENTCOM area. And many, many have noted throughout this conference and other endeavors that we have to streamline our sustainment operations. You talked about General Pagonis and his 3x5 cards. The model that I'm going to show you is just one effort to take all of the data from multiple systems, all of the logistics systems that we have in operation now, and put that into a flow model that will help us to visualize this major endeavor of bringing equipment and supplies out of Afghanistan, getting it to a port, either flying it to a port in the theater and then transferring it to a ship to come out of theater, where it will go to a port in the United States, from that port to a source of repair, whether that be a depot, a directorate of logistics, or the unit itself, or a commercial activity, how long that will take us to get it through, the dollar costs associated with each of those endeavors, and then, almost by serial number, when that piece of equipment will be fielded to the next unit waiting it for its next mission for training. So if we can get that flow model to... Now this is the first, and it's very, very early in its development. I actually picked the first edition of this because the data in here is not live data, it's not real data. And so it's just how we're putting the model together. And there, if we can get it to run there, we're counting the days associated with units in Afghanistan turning equipment in to the RPAT yards, the retrograde processing property accountability efforts that occur there, and it gets prepared, it gets agriculturally cleaned and prepared for further movement. It could be by multimodal move, that is, we'll put it on an aircraft that's leaving the theater, send it to one of the seaports, well, an airport in the theater, transfer it to a seaport, and then get it on its way across the ocean, as you see those ships moving across the ocean now, to a port in the United States, downloading it there and getting it to a source of repair. using the repair cycle times and the costs associated with each individual item of equipment, and then showing when it's going to be ready to go to the next unit. And we are using this visualization model and taking a look at all of the modes and the nodes and the cost associated, and we can drill down onto each of those elements and see, again, as I said, almost by serial number, what's happening with that piece of equipment, that system. So those are some of the endeavors to streamline the flow and reduce the transportation and the reset costs as we undertake this, as we're in the midst of this major endeavor of retrograding from Afghanistan. Next, I'll talk about delivering the warfighting capabilities in support of, you know, ASALT, our PEOs and PMs and AMCs, opportunities there in our S&T, our science and technology endeavors, our research and development, our weapons systems contracting, and our life cycle management and sustaining. And again, it's an effort to reduce the life cycle costs. We want to do that from the design phase on for any new systems coming aboard, taking into account requirements for operational energy, as Ray mentioned, and all of the repair parts costs, commonality there, what we can achieve, and then modernizing what we have on hand through our reset program, through capitalization efforts, modernization through our spares, condition-based maintenance, and also relooking how we do post-production software support. Because as Ray says, that is the costs associated with our software and licensing and field service representatives is increasing exponentially. We predict about 80% increase over the next 8 years. And that's not sustainable over the long term. We know that we have to consolidate our contracts. We have about Army Contracting Command, one of our major subordinate elements that General Vi talked about yesterday, has about $74 billion in contract obligations that it is managing. It actually does 1 out of 7 contracts for the entire, across the entire Department of Defense. So that is a considerable amount of contracting that goes on in support of our forces around the world. And we are looking for ways, better buying power that Ms. Hsu talked about, and ways to consolidate the requirements and make the best use of our contracting workforce, the very, very talented and dedicated professionals that we have in that program that we have grown in the last 10 years and continue to grow to meet the requirements. So we've got the Eagle and other contracting strategies that we're putting into effect, and we do very much appreciate all of the interest that we've had in the Eagle contracting strategy. Our first, you know, effort, as most of you know, has been for the DOLs, the Director of Logistics, how we can combine multiple contracts that we have out there on every installation across the Army for maintenance and for transportation and for supply operations into one contract vehicle. That reduces the cost of the overhead of the people performing the contract services themselves and decreases the complexity and the burden of managing those contracts throughout their life cycles. We also are rebalancing our sustainment force, as Ray mentioned, and through the global logistics posture. And then Ray also mentioned it's really important that we transition the skills to sustain our systems back to our soldiers. And so we have to partner on things like tech data and skills transfer. So I'd say that you can help by doing what you've done as our partners over the last 12 years, by looking at the requirements through the eyes of our soldiers and our civilians, as Ray said, that are out there on freedom's frontier, and making sure that we're providing them the best in processes and capabilities and weapons that we can possibly do. And if we'll go to the next and last slide. You know, we talked about the efforts to return soldiers to performing work that aligns with their MOSs, work that we've outsourced for very good reasons for the past 12 years. We can talk about it to each other and to ourselves, but we also know that it's critical to speak about it with our soldiers. And that always seems to work better when we rely on our non-commissioned officers to communicate that intent. So as I've done in the past at the Winter Symposium, I'll call on everybody's battle buddy, Master Sergeant Halfmast, to help carry that message. And if you'll play the video.
Hello, soldier. Master Sergeant Halfmast Mechanic from PS Magazine here. Today I'm going to talk about a challenge our Army faces as we transition from a focus on combat operations to a renewed effort on sustaining our equipment and materiel and building a common operating picture of Army equipment and readiness. For the past 11 years, we faced a tough enemy in two major wars, and I'm proud to say we've done well. But troop deployments to Afghanistan will be ending, and that means most of our equipment will be coming home too. We'll need a plan to maintain that equipment at our home stations. Now that we're going to see equipment back in our motor pools, we need to ensure we are trained and ready to maintain our equipment for all future operations. That means maintenance that may have been contracted out in Afghanistan will be put back in the hands of soldiers like you. So you'll be turning wrenches on your weapon systems along with old Half-Mast. You may not be firing and cleaning your weapons daily, but you'll still need to ensure they are lubed and maintained, ready for any mission. And you may need to do more to maintain communications equipment. We have to return to the basics of maintenance, supply, and training. That's right, training. Because preventive maintenance is a training event. NCOs must continue to teach their soldiers how to perform PMCS, how to fill out maintenance forms, and follow our troubleshooting procedures. Better automated tracking tools and good old maintenance meetings will help us track and improve our equipment readiness. After all, when leaders make maintenance a priority, everyone else will too. Supply accountability is critical. So performing regular inventories must be the norm. MOS training as well as additional skills training are essential to sustaining our equipment. Mobile training team visits will stress the importance of maintenance, supply, and training management. Our logistics assistance representatives are great sources of information and can assist you with maintenance and troubleshooting procedures. Leaders at Army Materiel Command and Department of the Army use the Army Materiel Common Operating Picture, or COP, to obtain an overview of equipment by unit, location, and status. Whether your unit is in the reset, train, ready, or available phase of R4Gen, the COP alerts commanders to developing supply problems. The COP allows AMC to spot key equipment shortages and to see any sourcing solutions to fix those shortages. AMC can further investigate a shortage to see whether it is a systemic problem Army-wide or whether a simple equipment transfer can fix the problem. The COP can also identify where excess equipment exists, and it can also find equipment at sources of repair that is ready for issue. The Army Materiel COP is all about making sure that soldiers like you get the right equipment in the right place at the right time. But the COP and equipment readiness all depend on you, soldiers. You develop the common operating picture through the maintenance and property accountability records you create. And soldiers, leaders, and civilian employees form the Army team that actually does preventive maintenance and sustains equipment readiness. So as I've been challenging you for the past 60 years, my question remains, would you stake your life right now on the condition of your equipment? Hoo-ah!
Very nice.
Okay, thank you very much, and I will pass to my right, Mike Ivey.
Good morning, General Sullivan. Duty first, mission always. Thanks for your leadership. Next slide. Next slide. I don't assume that everyone here knows who Oshkosh Corporation is, and particularly our allied friends that are here this morning. So just a quick infomercial for you. In a phrase, Oshkosh Corporation moves the world at work. We are both a commercial and a defense company. Nearly everything we do moves on wheels in demanding operational environments with value-adding technology. Between the four lines of business that you see across the top of this slide, we're able to leverage cross-segment manufacturing benefits and purchasing power. We share technology across all of our business units, including the command zone, which is a multiplexing technology that's found on Marine Corps trucks that we make, the TAC-4 independent suspension that's found on MRAPs, Marine Corps, and Army trucks. Those are examples of things that we share across the corporation. Together, these advantages create a business whose value, we believe, is greater than the sum of the parts. Within the matrix of this slide, you see the products that we make in Oshkosh Defense. In short, we are the Army's and the Marine Corps' supplier of medium and heavy tactical wheeled vehicles. We provide the MRAP all-terrain vehicle to our joint forces, and we have several offerings in the light vehicle category. Included in the latter is our light all-terrain vehicle, or the LATV, that was one of the three down selects for the EMD phase of the JLTV program. So that's who we are in Oshkosh. Next slide. This slide is a snapshot of our truck business over the past 5 years and looking forward into the next 2 years. As we think about transition to sustainment, the order of magnitude change in our volumes going into FYs 14 and 15 are a microcosm of what the DOD and the defense business writ large face in the near term. And so when I think about transition to sustainment, I think about how we transition from the world of high volumes that we've experienced for the past few years into the world of seemingly exceedingly low volumes that we face. We've achieved the high volumes that our customer required over the past 3 years by investing in production resources, primarily facilities and skilled labor. About as quickly as we stood up those capabilities, we're now ramping them down. Make no mistake, we will lose significant capacity. We have a responsibility to all of our stakeholders to operate our business efficiently and profitably, and we cannot do that by sitting on idle capacity. So we have begun the difficult work of aligning our workforce and facilities to the reality of the next couple of years. Our doing this creates new risk for our business and for the DOD. Recall that as recently as 2009, the DOD needed all-terrain MRAPs for the fight in Afghanistan quickly. We responded with the MATV and delivered more than 8,000 in a little over a year. We could do that because we had capacity. We simply will not have the ability to respond similarly going forward. Yet budgetary pressures are very real and apparently very unavoidable. So what's an Army to do? What's a business to do to mitigate the risk? And that's the subject of my next slide, please. So I've got some what I think are very practical ideas for what we can do together to mitigate risk going forward. No one of these by itself will provide the capability that the DOD needs and will need in the future. I won't prescribe how much of one versus the other, but I'll propose them all as food for thought. First, as my esteemed colleagues down the table have already alluded to, the Army must maintain its fleets in being. You have a responsibility to the nation to do that, and doing so will help sustain your industrial base. Secondly, the JLTV program, as the only active tactical wheeled vehicle acquisition, is critical to sustaining the tactical wheeled vehicle industrial base. I'm not sufficiently naive to suggest that one program will sustain the entire tactical wheeled vehicle industrial base, but it is critically important to your industrial base. And by the way, your Army and Marine Corps, soldiers and Marines, need the mobility and survivability that the JLTV platform brings to the table. Third, TACWIL vehicle recap programs provide the Army like new, and when I say like new, I mean latest configuration, 0 hour, 0 miles, new truck warranty, like new vehicles at less than the cost of new, sometimes significantly so. Even in lean times, recap programs offer the Army a way to continue modernizing at reduced cost and without overshooting acquisition objectives in a given program. Fourth, we in industry must continue to invest in manufacturing and after-sales knowledge systems that will improve our competitiveness when business rebounds. At Oshkosh, e-book represents a means to disseminate information about quality issues, whether supply or manufacturing issues, across the enterprise at the time of discovery in real time. In cooperation with our PM customers, we're also putting a system in place to build a much more robust database to support life cycle cost estimations and analysis. Fifth, some government investment, even at low levels, will maintain a level of vibrancy and forward thinking in the tack wheel vehicle community, both government and industry. We must continue advancing survivability solutions, for example, or we will expose soldiers unnecessarily on the first day of the next war. We think that one good way to protect soldiers is remove them from the vehicle altogether with autonomous drive, but this requires investment both in dollars and in doctrine, tactics, techniques, and procedures. And we ought to invest at some level in thinking about the next FMTV and FHTV, their requirements, the cost drivers, and the trade space between those. Anytime I'm on stage with General McQuistion, promoting public-private partnerships appears on my slide somewhere, and so here it is.
Thank you, Mike.
Of course, we had a whole panel discussion yesterday on public-private partnerships. We in industry, at least in the tack wheel vehicle industry, acknowledge that this is not a either-or proposition. It's a both together proposition, and we've got to improve our efficiencies in pursuing those public-private relationships. And finally, while we know that international opportunities cannot make up for the downturn in U.S. DoD spending, international customers are nonetheless more important than ever to sustaining the U.S. defense industrial base. Getting the world's best equipment into the militaries of our allies is also of strategic interest to the United States. We think that the U.S. government could do more to promote sales of U.S. defense companies internationally, not by relaxing export or other important controls, but by partnering with us as we approach that marketplace. We know that it all has to be transparent and above board and would never suggest anything other than that, but an occasional endorsement for our products from our largest customer might be helpful. So I've tried to provide a straightforward assessment of our business stance without whining. We have to live in and face the reality such as it is. I think these are some practical ideas that we can do together as our tack wheel vehicle industrial base faces real headwinds in the years to come. General Greene?
Let me start, Mike, by telling you that we love your trucks. And it's a little intimidating to be after this panel and especially after Master Sergeant Halftrack, so I'll try and live up to the standard that's been set. I'd like to come at this from sustaining the advantage that our soldiers hold on the battlefield today, because I think that's really the focus that we have to have in ASALT, at least for the material part of it. And my objective today is twofold. First, I'm going to hopefully provide you a perspective on the transitions we're facing, and next slide, how we're responding in ASALT. And secondly, I hope I trigger some questions so that we can have a dialogue, and I'll try not to take up all the time so there is time for questions. On this slide, I'll start in the upper right. Certainly, we all know that we have a changing times, a change in strategy, 11 plus going on 12 years of conflict in Afghanistan and Iraq, and now we look to the future defense strategy and the changes that that portends. Going to the lower right, obviously, we still plan to be an army engaged in the world. You've all heard about regionally aligned forces, so there's a mission for the army, and it goes beyond Afghanistan, and we have to be prepared to that. Going to the lower left, I'm not going to say much about that. General Barclay's up next, and I'm sure he's going to talk about where we are in PPBE and the fiscal challenges that we face in the uncertain times, but certainly that's an impact. And that gets me to the upper left, and a picture of an MRAP. Certainly, we're in a transition from a time of ample resourcing while we're in conflict to what the future will bring in terms of resourcing and our ability to put new capability in the field. And we've made tremendous improvements in our Army over the last 12 years. We found ways to get things to our soldiers rapidly and do rapid acquisition. So one of the things that we're working right now as part of the Army headquarters transformation is looking at how we instantiate a capability to do rapid acquisition. Certainly it's not going to be at the level of which with which we've done it the past few years with all of the OCO funding that we had available, but we need to have that capability, and we need to have a way to ramp it back up when we need it at the time of the next conflict. Second thing we're going to do is we're going to be bringing a lot of gear home and deciding what to do with it, and General McQuistion touched on it in terms of getting gear to units. I'm going to touch a little bit later on the challenge we have with all the quick reaction capabilities that we've developed, which have certainly brought capability to our Army, but now they bring a challenge to us of what do we do with that capability. So next slide, please. In that environment, my boss, Ms. Hsu, has really focused us on looking at developing strategic plans so we make smart choices for the future. This is a prototypical sand chart. We didn't want to put an actual sand chart up for fear we'd give away the transition points. I know Mike's up here trying to read the slide. There's nothing on the axes, Mike. You can't get it. But we're looking at what should drive our decisions in the future, and I know I've talked to some of you, and you've said, how can you possibly predict what science and technology you're going to be doing in 30 years? We can't. But what we can predict is when we might see inflection points, and you see across the top some of the things that are going to drive inflection points. For instance, obsolescence. Mike talked about trucks. In the last 10 years, we've gotten pretty healthy in medium and heavy tactical trucks. That's the good news. The bad news is that in about 10 years, our average fleet age is going to be approaching half the economic useful life, and we're going to have a decision. We're going to have to do something. Next factor you see up there is technology. Certainly, technology will enable future capabilities. It will probably also drive the need for future capabilities as our adversaries leverage that technology. Third one there is affordability. Anything we do has got to be affordable. The threat certainly gets a vote, and as we look at the future defense strategy, you see that we're going to have a change. We're going to go into contested environments where things like the electromagnetic spectrum is not going to be free and open to us. There are going to be people who would attempt to deny it to us, and we have to be prepared to deal with that. And finally, the change in mission. We're very familiar with the mission in Iraq and Afghanistan, but certainly the next fight will not be the same as the one we had before. So she's focused us on things like developing sand charts and look at your portfolio and your fleet and see where it is and try and predict those inflection points. Look at the science and technology investments we're making now and when they could come in to our fleets. Look at what we should be looking to for future science and technology initiatives, what we should be looking at in basic research, and begin to think about that. We don't for a minute think that we have a 30-year crystal ball and we see everything that's out there. But if we don't have a plan to adjust from, we certainly won't get it right as we look to the future. So she's pushing us to do a couple things. Look at what we think the inflection points are, synchronize our science and technology funding with our other research development tests and evaluation funding and our procurement funding, and synchronize it on the back end with our sustainment funding so we can make smart choices. Next slide, please. What that's driving us to is to develop roadmaps, and this happens to be one of them. She talked about it in her presentation on Wednesday, but we didn't actually show one. This is the challenge chart for enhanced mobility, and it really refers to the rotary wing aviation fleet. What you see at the top are the systems that you're very familiar with, along with the future vertical lift medium, which is the future platform that we're working on. And then at the bottom, you see the science and technology objectives. And the idea is that we're trying to map those science and technology objectives back into the programs we have now and the capabilities we have now so we can plan out to the future. Now, this particular one only goes out to FY33. Clearly, we have to go further. But you see that the future vertical lift, Milestone C, is out there in about FY 29 or 30. That's driven by our science and technology and the improvements that we're making in our current force systems. So we're looking through these portfolios to understand within a given portfolio where the inflection points are. And then, of course, the next step is we'll have to be looking cross portfolio to make sure we get the balance right. And certainly General Barclay will have something to say about that. But we need to do that. We have to make smart investment choices as we look to the future. And these things are related. Next slide, please. Oh, and I would state on that slide that the intention is that we're going to share those investment roadmaps and plans with industry. We're looking for your comments and looking for your ideas on the feasibility of the plans. So next slide, please. So looking at what we've done in the past, we'd also like to leverage the investment of the past 12 years. We've bought an awful lot of stuff, and not all of it that we bought was in programs of record. And the beauty of a program of record is that the system drives you to make sure that it's sustainable and you have all of the pieces and parts you need. You have the maintenance manuals, you have the training, you have the repair parts, you have the depot work instructions. You didn't necessarily get that with quick reaction capabilities. The good news was we got capability to soldiers quickly. The bad news is we may not have bought all of the things we needed to sustain them. And we worked around that in many cases by procuring contractor logistics support. Now as we look at those capabilities, we have some decisions to make. So we're going through all of those capabilities through both the capabilities development for rapid transition process, which is a TRADOC run process, and also through an Army Requirements Oversight Council to look at all the non-standard equipment and decide, is this a capability we want to retain? So we'll keep it as is. But we will go procure the necessary things we need to make it sustainable. The training materials, the maintenance instructions, and so on. Is it something we want to invest in? We want to put our science and technology and our investment account funds in to get the next generation of this capability. Is it something we just want to maintain for the current fight because it's only a niche capability specific to that environment, in which case we'll maintain it with OCO funds and at the conclusion of the OCO funds will divest ourselves of the system, or is it something we're ready to divest now? Certainly we want to leverage everything we can out of the investment of the past 12 years, but we want to do it in a smart way, do it in a way that's affordable so we can sustain it to the future. And that brings me to the last slide I have, and hopefully to your questions. We're focusing on affordability. We talked a little bit about it in better buying power. We're looking at divesting excess equipment, and on those we keep emphasizing suitability and sustainability. If we bought it as a QRC, we need to make sure it's suitable and sustainable for the long term. Transitioning from organic or from contractor logistics support in many cases to organic support, and bringing these systems and capabilities into our institutional training, where today it may be trained only by a contractor forward in theater. If we're going to keep it for the long term, after we come back from the theater, we need to instantiate it in our routine processes. And then finally, looking at making our systems affordable for the future. So in this page, across the bottom, we've highlighted the improved turbine engine program, which is one of our science and technology objectives, which is in this year is transitioning into a program of record. And it's motherhood and apple pie, designed to give us a replacement for the T700 engine. It improves reliability, reduces fuel consumption, and it's going to allow us to buy back lost capability and capacity. Who couldn't like it? It is a product of our science and technology efforts in AMC, and we're now going to bring it into the fleet. And with success, and we expect it to succeed. It's gone all the way up through and has demonstrated technology readiness level 6. It's going to bring us all of those things. Improve reliability, reduce cost, and we're going to buy back capacity and have an engine to carry us to the future. So I come at this from a little bit different perspective, but I think it's all part of the same thing. We've given our soldiers an advantage on the battlefield, and in the transition to sustainment, we really have to sustain that advantage. And with that, sir, I turn it back to you for questions.
Well, thanks, Harry, and thanks to all the panel members, and thanks to you. We've gotten some great questions from you. Keep them coming. We've got another 30 minutes or so here, but what I'd like to do now is start with several of the panel members have more than one question. I'd like each panel member to take one question and answer it, and then as we finish those up, we'll come back around for a second round. So, Ray, why don't you start us off?
Sure. So the question is, what is the status of CBM, or condition-based maintenance? And this was asked by an aviator in the crowd. I won't say who it is, but his name rhymes with Jim Pillsbury. But so I would say that even for the aviation fleet, the glass is more than half full, you know, when you think about prognostics and diagnostics. But as I talk to the aviation community, even that fleet, for the CBM purists, the disciples of CBM, they would say that fleet's only about 60% actually embedded with those kinds of capabilities. So we still have a ways to go in the aviation fleet. Most people would think, it's got those kinds of CBM things built into it. Well, it does, but it's got a ways to go too. And as Harry talked about some of the science and technology piece, for the ground fleet, we've got a long way to go. You know, just the computers you have in your cars, when you go in to pull maintenance on it, and you plug it into this little thing and it tells you all the problems with it. We have some of that, but not a lot. So we've got a long way to go in the ground fleet with condition-based maintenance. I've given this task, at least from a policy and program standpoint, within the G4 team to the Logistics Innovation Agency, LIA. So if you're interested in CBM, that's your door into the G4 LIA. In fact, we just hired a new director of LIA. Mike Williams came to us from SDDC, great SES. Vic Ramdas headed down to Florida this way, actually. He's working for Southcom. So the challenge is we don't really have a really good model to determine the investment up front in a system to what it's going to give you over life cycle costs. We've got some reasonable models. They're somewhat rudimentary, but we're on a real kind of crusade, I would almost say, between AMC, the ASALT community, and others to try to figure out how can we have a really good analytical model with calculus that can tell you if you invest these kinds of things up front in a system, this is what it's going to give you over the life cycle of that particular weapon system. As Pat said, we're keeping things longer and longer. Ms. Hsu has initiated a program, and I think I've got the acronym about right. It's called LIRA, and Harry, you correct me if I've got it off, but I think it basically means long-range investment and resource analysis. And so it's really more human involvement right now. It's got some math behind it, but we get in the room and we try to figure out what are these downstream costs. If we decide to embed prognostics into a system, of course, that causes every system to be more expensive, and PEOs and PMs then can buy less systems. So, you know, they're all about wanting to field more and more systems out there, and I kind of understand that. But if we can convince them over the life cycle it's going to dramatically reduce that 70% tail that Pat mentioned, then maybe it makes sense to buy a few less of them. And it's this downstream issue. So if this vehicle breaks down less, the mean time between failure, that means I need less mechanics on the battlefield. Those mechanics then eat less food. You need less, you know, you can just see the second, third, fourth order effects. And this is, I mean, this is heavy math. And so this model we're trying to work, we're looking to industry. I know the auto industry has some pretty good models. They figure out if they invest X amount in a particular component inside the vehicle, where's that trade-off point? So we have a good partnership doing this. Ms. Hsu has truly stepped out with this. Within the PEGs we talked about, within the SS and the EE PEG, in the weapon systems review, we have a partnership there. In fact, Tom Mullins from ASALT and I co-chair the SS PEG. He's from the ASALT side. But, you know, and I look at myself as the L in ASALT for Ms. Hsu. And so that's my point, is to keep driving this issue about we need to invest in prognostics, we need to invest in diagnostics to get condition-based maintenance so you can see something before it breaks. And then I would also just offer the whole operational energy piece. The ITEP that Harry talked about, the improved turbine engine program, lets helicopters fly higher, carry more weight at higher temperatures, and for us in the sustainment side, uses about 25% less fuel. And so we were able to kind of demonstrate that, so that investment up front. So glass is more than half full on CBM, but a lot more to go, and looking for help on that. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Ray. Graz, how about you?
Yeah, the question says, are we making any progress on lightweight armor for combat or tactical wheeled vehicles? Yes. No, that's probably not. We probably want more than that. It's interesting this question would actually come to me. Somebody knows something. I would tell you that in December 2011, General Dynamics acquired Force Protection Industries. Many of you are aware of what comes with Force Protection Industries, the Buffalo vehicle, the Cougar vehicle. But what some of you may not know is that also what came with Force Protection Industries is a world-class development and testing range in South Carolina, and it's truly world-class. And so as our nature at General Dynamics, we took a look at what they do very well, and one of the things is development of lightweight armor. I can tell you that without getting very specific, that we have indeed developed lightweight armor for specific threats that's significantly lighter than what we have. It has been through government testing. I can tell you, excuse me, that we're not resting there. We actually have a lighter one that has been tested at our range, but is not through government testing. So the answer is yeah, absolutely. You know, the issue is, and we're talking, of course, to our clients about that, this armor, is that as we wind down in our theater of war, the requirement for this becomes less urgent. So, but it's not going to stop us from doing the right thing for soldiers and in the joint force. So we do have it, and we're working on even better solutions.
Thanks, Graz.
Yep.
Pat, how about taking one of your questions?
All right, sir. As a former CG of Army Sustainment Command, is what we built in ASC going to endure? That's a great question. I believe it must endure. We do have to take some pretty significant actions to move the resourcing of Army Sustainment Command from what is heavily leveraged with OCO funding now into the base program over time. But it really is the basis upon which we are regionally aligned to support future regional line force for the COCOMs. So I think it must endure. I know that it will continue to develop and morph over time. You know, we've just given it the mission to do the Directorate of Logistics across 73 installations all across our Army, wherever our forces are. That's where ASC is. It also does the Army pre-positioned stocks at all locations. And as we continue to take a look at the equipment coming out of Afghanistan and where we want to posture additional activity sets, it also is responsible for handling those, just like our APS. So the European activity set that we're constituting in Germany currently, and as the Army takes a look to see where else around the world we might want to posture some training fleets. It also provides our logistics assistance representatives, our LARs. And we know that we've got a lot of work to do there to train the LARs. And as we make decisions on what other equipment, the non-standard equipment that is going to come into our force, we want to also take advantage of those LARs and train them in the new weapon systems that are coming in, the new C4ISR capabilities. So those LARs, both for weapon systems and supply support to our tactical units, are critical to the ability to sustain our Army. The prepare to deploy training equipment. Everything that Army Sustainment Command does is needed for the future. And so, yes, I think that we will sustain those formations. I think, as I said, it's part of our global logistics concept that we continue to develop. It is the operational arm of Army Materiel Command. It links the tactical units to the full extent of the industrial base. The federal, industrial base. So, it manages contractors, it manages the logistics civil augmentation program, and contractors on the battlefield. There are so many capabilities that it provides for forces around the world that we can't stand it down without considerable reposturing and standing something else in its place. I'd like to think, from what we hear from the folks that we support out in the field, the AMC patch is recognized primarily through our Army Field Support Brigades that are part of Army Sustainment Command, and I'd like to think that the tactical warfighter will not let us stand it down. They have come to rely on it so heavily.
Pat keeps looking at me because I've got to put it in the palm. So, and I will, because I would say the Army can't afford not to have Army Sustainment Command. They extend the enterprise deep into the battle space. I mean, AMC is at the foxhole all the way back to the national level, perhaps like it never has in the past. And so you've got my support, and I'll keep working it, Pat.
Thanks, Pat. Mike, how about taking one of your questions?
Sure. This will attach to General Mason's discussion of CBM. Has Oshkosh looked at the potential benefits of CBM? That, of course, would be in TACWIL vehicles and MATV. Does it make sense to retrofit any of our existing TACWIL vehicle fleet to get a CBM capability? How much per vehicle? I'll answer the last question first. How much per vehicle? I will work that pricing up and get it right out. Get it right out to you.
Better be low.
That's a normal. That's fairly normal feedback. The answer is yes. We use commercial engines and commercial transmissions in every tactical wheel vehicle platform that we make. CAT engines and all of our defense products are equipped with the sensor suite capability that would support CBM, as are the Allison transmissions that we use. We don't take advantage of that capability because we're not paid to do so. And when we have those discussions with the PMs that pay our bills, the PMs have no requirements for that. And so, to General Mason's point, that he made earlier, there needs to be, in my opinion, some work done on the Army side to substantiate whether it's worth the cost of doing it or not. And if it's worth the cost, doing it is relatively straightforward. But that's really an Army decision. Would not be hard to execute technically, and would be very affordable, we think. But the Army's got to decide it wants it.
Yep.
So. Okay. Thanks, Mike. And Harry, how about you?
Mine, sir, really isn't a question. It was a suggestion that we talk a little bit more about SSTS, system-specific technical support. And I'm a big believer in that. It's kind of odd that the PM guy's answering the SSTS question, but that's okay.
I can't wait to hear what you're going to say.
Well, actually, sir, I'm going to say that I think it's incredibly important, because we've really changed models. As a young product manager, I beat my head against the SSTS system because it was really focused on parts on a shelf and LARS. And as we have transitioned over the last 10 to 12 years, I think you would be hard-pressed to find a system that isn't driven by electronics, by Moore's Law. And I would argue that every one of our systems has an obsolescence problem that we're going to have to deal with in hardware and software, and it's absolutely essential that we have the SSTS funding to enable us to do life cycle management. Those things are not just parts on a shelf. It isn't Jeeps with carburetors we need to repair anymore. It's electronically driven and controlled systems, and our system-specific technical support is absolutely essential to keeping those things going. How'd I do for the G4 today, sir? Okay.
That's a go. That's a go at that station.
Jim Barclay's revising all of his remarks now.
Thanks, Harry. And I'd like to come back now to General Mason for another one of his questions.
Okay. It's a question. It says, with the increased emphasis on A2AD, which is anti-access air denial, and the need for Army watercraft and logistics over the shore capability, will the Army finally stop trying to divest or transition their watercraft to the Navy? In the past 30 years, it says we've done this every 4 years or so, and I suspect that's probably true. We may do it again in 4 years, but I'll fight that, and General Stevenson did it before me as well. We have a requirement, number one, to push logistics over that shore into the battle space that the Navy might be interested in, but certainly not a core competency of theirs, nor do they see it as a central piece requirement, and I'll kind of describe why. Now, I'm not picking on the Navy, it's just, you know, what their mission set is. The Marines obviously also go over the shore, and they've got some inherent capabilities in their vehicles and their platforms that they can kind of deal with logistics over the shore with helicopters and other things of that nature. So we've got a requirement, and in fact, in a number of our op plans, and as well as humanitarian aid operations, Army watercraft and all that kind of ugly-looking stuff, and it's ugly. That's one of the challenges with it. Is, I mean, the barge derrick, have you ever seen one of those things? It looks like the farthest thing from warfighting you'd ever imagine, but it's key. And so the watercraft, the lighterage, the LSVs, it's a little unfortunate what happened with the theater support vessel. We were going to buy about 9 of those, and 6 of those were going to be for the Army and 3 for the Navy. The Army backed out of that program, and it'll be a Navy program exclusively. But anyway, there's going to be a JLOTS exercise in Korea this year in the spring, and it'll demonstrate logistics over the shore, fuel going over the shore, lighterage going from in-stream out of ships going across the shore. And so you got the Navy piece there. You got a naval beach group, you got Seabees, you got Army, you got all that piece. It does keep me up at night, as I mentioned, you know, because of, I don't think we're going to have the luxury of a thing like Kuwait in the future. They're going to try to deny us that. Logistics over the shore is one of the ways to support our forces. It is very fragile. You've got to have air superiority. You've got to push back direct fire weapons for sure. But a couple indirect weapons could put damage it significantly. I mean, think about D-Day, the morning of D-Day, and seeing all that stuff out there, the Mulberry, you know, stuff that was out there. That's kind of Army watercraft logistics over the shore. Some of the technology is there, and some of it's pretty old. But bottom line is, as far as I'm concerned, it's a key capability. We've got a comparative advantage there that we need to maintain, and it's key to our op plans, and it's key to other capabilities across the nation and around the world. So I'm a big proponent, and I'll continue to be for that.
Thanks, Ray. Pat, how about another question from you?
Okay. In the last BRAC, a number of Army functions transitioned to DLA, the Defense Logistics Agency. As a former DSCC commander and now the DCG for AMC, how's that working out for the Army? you know, it's about relationships, and it is about defining metrics and holding each other accountable for performance. And I think that we're doing that better than we had predicted we would be able to do in the early phases of the BRAC decisions. I think that a lot of that is because we have a lot of Army experience, Army logisticians that have served in DLA. Ray, certainly, Gus Perna has, Daryl Williams, Lynn Collier. You know, Sue Davidson now is the distribution commander for DLA, and Ken Dowd's there now as the J3. And I think we have to continue that. We have to continue to place Army officers in those key positions within DLA to keep us tied together. And we talk to each other quite frequently. Admiral Harnachek and General Vi, you know, constituted a series of meetings where we engage with the Army G4 and DLA. We have monthly meetings with Ken Dowd, and then quarterly meetings with the entire community coming together to talk about the areas of intersection and how we rely on each other. You know, this current fiscal uncertainty certainly has impacts on their ability to demand plan and posture for the future as well in support of our weapon systems. So we are cognizant of that in ways that we wouldn't have been if we hadn't had those experiences of leading those DLA enterprise activities as well. I will say we probably talk together better than our systems do currently, so there's more work to be done in linking the enterprise business system with our logistics modernization program and really getting that logic worked out so that we're working along the same kind of logic streams and not competing against the systems. So I hope that answers the question. Better than predicted in 2005.
Okay. Thanks, Pat. Mike, have you got another one down there?
As we continue to sustain our vehicle fleets, in some cases with CLS, can our soldiers work with contractors in a partnership so they can train and learn? I suggest that's already happening. It's not just Oshkosh FSRs. I'm sure it's General Dynamics FSRs and FSRs from any number of you folks who sit out here today, many of them former soldiers, all of them trained in their systems by the OEMs, all of them with reach-back capability. In fact, Graz coined a term that I like, industrial-based technical reach-back. That's what FSRs bring to the equation. And they're already out there training soldiers and maintenance leaders to do what needs to be done. We've had in Oshkosh 300 to 400 FSRs operating in Afghanistan for the last 3 years or so. That's starting to wind down, but they're still out there. We also offer a virtual training capability that would be an affordable solution for training soldiers. In fact, anybody who would like to see that demonstrated, we're doing that down on the floor now. But back to FSRs for just a minute. Again, our customers got to be willing to pay for FSRs. We have done some mix over the last years of providing some self-funded FSRs, even as the Army paid for some FSRs. So it was a mix. But I showed you our volume chart, and we will not be able to self-fund FSRs as we go forward into 14 and 15. We just won't be able to afford it. So if the Army wants that capability, it's a very affordable capability, but they're going to have to pay for it.
Thanks, Mike. Harry.
Sir, given the AAAD new normal, anti-access area denial, how will the Army engage our sister services to develop and field platforms to deliver immediately employable, capable Army formations directly into the operational area, giving us the global maneuver capability required in AAAD strategic environments? That's a tough question. First of all, I would really suggest that that's a question that should also be addressed to the concepts and strategic S&T panel that follows, I think, two after us, because there's a conceptual doctrinal portion to that. But there are a number of things that we're doing today to enable that. So I would refer back to what General Mason described with our transportation infrastructure and our logistics over the shore capabilities. We're also enabling much of our C4ISR work to be done as reach back so that we can provide capabilities forward without delivering a large footprint forward. And we're doing a number of key things in some areas that are key to AAAD. For instance, in air and missile defense, the Army's a key player, and there are OSD and joint staff forums that are synchronizing the various portions of air and missile defense that come from all the services to enable us to operate in that kind of environment. There is an EW coordinating board that's working on developing both the material solutions but also the .mil PF solutions for operating in denied environments. One example of that is the work that's ongoing with how we operate in areas where the attempt is made to deny us position, navigation, and timing information. And I can't talk in much detail here, but suffice it to say that there is work ongoing. Translate position, navigation, and timing to GPS. We're also doing work in areas such as aircraft survivability to enable our air platforms to operate in those kind of environments. So there is a lot of work ongoing now to move ourselves from an environment focused on COIN to one that is more threatening and more denied, and it is working in conjunction with all of the other services.
Thanks, Harry. And we've got time for one more, I think. So, Graz, let's go to you.
Sure. It says, Graz, from your position as the Vice President for Combat Support and Sustainment and Land Systems, what is your biggest concern in terms of sustaining your workforce? Wow, I could, I could go on for a long time, but let me just talk about the FSRs in particular. I think the biggest concern is getting at the forecasting of requirements as we go forward. I think that's fed by open and collaborative communications with our clients, and we have that at every level. We have that. As you may know, General Dynamics Land Systems is really everywhere our Army is. It's still in Iraq, and it will be there until the Army says come home. Our professionals are there. So we're very agile and we can adjust, but I'd say the one concern is that we continue to be open and collaborative, transparent in requirements so that we can continue to be agile and be everywhere the Army needs us to be when we're there. So.
Thanks, Chris. We've got 1 minute. Can you do one in 1 minute?
1 minute. let me say this about that. Tiered readiness, and I'll be quick. R4 Gen Great system, served us very, very well, but it's not an inexpensive system. Every unit in the Army theoretically would become an ALO-1 most ready unit. They'd move along that path. That's not what we need, certainly in the interwar years. Whether we need it in the next war, we're working our way through it. So do you go to cyclical readiness? Do you go to tiered readiness? Do you go to progressive readiness? I'll be honest with you, we have not figured it out. We've got smart guys in the building trying to figure this out. I will say this, the reserve component forces are absolutely key to this. The operationalized reserve, what they've done in the last 10 years is absolutely incredible. And again, in the sustainment world, along with some of the other commodity area, other functional areas, engineers, medical, we rely on the reserve components. We've got to bring them along in this readiness path we're going on. We got to keep them trained and ready as well. One of the programs we used to have, many of you all remember this in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, was called Capstone. We aligned active and reserve units together for training. We're moving in that same direction. I'm just concerned as we deploy less and less, which is a good thing, we'll lose contact with our reserve brothers and sisters. We can't let that happen. That's a big part of our readiness.
Very good. Sir.
Okay, world class. That's a great panel. I want to pick up on something that was said about the foreign overseas market here. Roger Thompson just came back from IDEX, which is in Abu Dhabi, and there were over 60,000 attendees at IDEX, which is a defense show. 59 countries were represented. And over 1,000, almost 1,200 companies were represented. And AUSA was the sponsor of the U.S. Pavilion, and we were number one in IDEX. Now, I guess what I'm telling you is there's ways to get the word out to the rest of the world that the U.S. has world-class equipment. We'll be in LANPAC here coming up in April. That's the Land Power in the Pacific. We have a modest show there. Istanbul, first year for the Turkish land show. And we're already expanding the footprint that we're putting there because of the demand. And next year, of course, Euro Saturday in Paris. I would tell you, by the way, that the French are looking to see multi-use equipment. That is equipment which can be used for hazmat, civilian hazmat, as well as military use. So those of you who make wheeled vehicles or do that kind of stuff might want to think about that. By the way, when you go to these shows, you get the U.S. ambassador on site, the Office of Defense Cooperation, U.S. commercial office, how to do business. That tells you customers, the people that display how to do business in overseas areas, and the DOD Security Cooperation Agency and State Department and so forth and so on. My point is that there are ways for industry to get their product overseas, and if you talk to Roger Thompson or Michael Scanlon, anybody here from the commercial sector, we're willing to help you out in those areas. And then, of course, we've got the annual meeting and so forth and so on. I'm just going to weigh in. I have a bias, and I'm going to show it. I don't think the United States of America can do just cause again. I don't think we have the capability to do a just cause. Just cause was the invasion in Panama in 1989 when we took down 27 objectives from about midnight until daylight and essentially shut the country down. It was a case of troops on the ground, airborne soldiers from Fort Bragg, special ops guys, rangers, and so forth and so on, and air landed. If we kill production of the C-17, we will pay a price for that, just as we will pay a price for not having over-the-shore capability in the United States Army. Some over-shore capability. And it's a question of dollars. But, you can't talk about anti-access and not talk about air insertion, either airborne or heli-landed. And I'm not sure where we are with our helicopter fleet going forward, given the kind of dollars we've got. But at any rate, Okay, gang, take 45 minutes. The beneficent AUSA giving you 45 minutes for a break. Thanks a lot, guys. Nice panel. Guys and gals.
You happy with the...